things come to thermal equilibrium, isolated systems, particles in a box, sealed off, a sealed off box, or just systems otherwise isolated from other systems, they come to thermal equilibrium in time. And the time for things to come to thermal equilibrium is very rapid. Doesn't take long. Long on what scale, don't worry about it, but still, you see things come to thermal equilibrium pretty quickly. Now, a black hole is a system which is in thermal equilibrium. And if you think about how long it takes from the time that black hole is first created, when its horizon is first created, how long does it come to thermal equilibrium? Very fast. And from the general relativity point of view, it's just that the area of the horizon very quickly settles down, starts out very small, area starts out a tiny little area and expands, and then stops expanding. And that's when it comes to thermal equilibrium. That, if you take the case of a solar mass black hole, a solar mass black hole would come to thermal equilibrium in less than a millisecond. If you did something to the black hole, which kicked it way out of thermal equilibrium, it would come back to thermal equilibrium in somewhere between a micro and a millisecond. So very fast things come to thermal equilibrium. On the other hand, if you look at Einstein's equations and you ask not how the area of the horizon grows, that's one feature, but you ask how the volume of the interior of the black hole grows, it grows for an exponentially long time, a huge amount of time. So the question was, what is it that's growing in the interior of the black hole? What information theoretic quantity, what quantity is growing? In the case of the area of the black hole, it comes to thermal equilibrium quickly. It was the entropy of the black hole. Something else continues to grow for a very long time. We've known that just from Einstein's field equations. What is that thing? The only known thing that continues to grow long after a thing comes to thermal equilibrium is what's called complexity, quantum computational complexity. And that takes a huge amount of time, exponentially long, for it to settle down. So I guess I put forward the idea that this long, long time growth of the interior of the black hole, which can't be seen from the outside, that long, long time growth was the growth of quantum computational complexity. Quantum computational complexity is a very, very subtle quantity. It's a quantity that quantum computer scientists know about. It was a property that I don't think any except for one or two people that I knew had ever even thought about or even heard about. I can tell you in a minute what complexity means, but this was not part of a theoretical physicist's tools. So when I put it forward, it very quickly caught on. It was not one of these things where it took a long time for people to realize that it might be right. And it caught on, and people learned what complexity is. Now, every single person who's interested in quantum mechanics and gravity has become probably more expert than I am on what quantum complexity means. So I'll tell you what complexity means. It comes out of computer science. It's a question of how long it takes for a system to achieve whatever state you're interested in, some target state. You would like it to get into some state, starting with some simple state, by simple operations. Simple operations mean operations that only involve individually small number of degrees of freedom. If we were talking about a quantum computer, we would be talking about operations which only involve a small number of qubits at a time. Could be just pairs of qubits. Gates, the word is a gate. A gate is an operation which takes place on a small number of degrees of freedom. How many gates does it take to achieve a certain state? The minimum number of gates that you can use to achieve a certain state. That minimum number is called the complexity of the state. Now, complexity can continue to increase in quantum mechanics for a very, very long time, exponentially long time. In classical physics, it's not true. In classical physics, complexity saturates about the same time as thermal equilibrium comes about. In quantum mechanics, this was something Feynman realized. It was his explanation about why quantum mechanics is so hard, because there are just so many states to wade through. And quantum complexity can be vastly larger than what can be achieved in a reasonable amount of time. So the only thing that I could think of that this growing interior of the black hole could be connected to was quantum complexity. And I made some arguments, I gave some examples, I tested it out in various properties of complexity versus properties of black holes, and they matched. This was a surprise to most black hole physicists. They'd never heard of complexity for the most part. I think the only people that I know that even knew what complexity meant were my colleague Patrick Hayden, who is actually a computer scientist in addition to being a physicist. And one of my students, Dan Harlow, they knew what complexity was. And in fact, to some extent, they even taught me what complexity was. To my knowledge, those are the only two physicists that I had ever heard of who knew what complexity was. Now everybody knows what it is. So yes, it does appear that the growth of the interior of black holes is the growth of computational complexity. The state of the black hole just gets more and more and more complex for a long, long period, much longer than it takes for it to come to thermal equilibrium. And that was a surprise.
Just a moment. Don't go anywhere. Hey, I see you inching away. Don't be like the economy. Instead, read The Economist. I thought all The Economist was something that CEOs read to stay up to date on world trends. And that's true, but that's not only true. What I found more than useful for myself, personally, is their coverage of math, physics, philosophy, and AI, especially how something is perceived by other countries and how it may impact markets. For instance, The Economist had an interview with some of the people behind DeepSeek the week DeepSeek was launched. No one else had that. Another example is The Economist has this fantastic article on the recent dark energy data, which surpasses even Scientific American's coverage, in my opinion. They also have the chart of everything. It's like the chart version of this channel. It's something which is a pleasure to scroll through and learn from. Links to all of these will be in the description, of course. Now, The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means that you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments. I am personally interested in the more scientific ones, like this one on extending life via mitochondrial transplants, which creates actually a new field of medicine, something that would make Michael Levin proud. The Economist also covers culture, finance and economics, business, international affairs, Britain, Europe, the Middle East, Africa, China, Asia, the Americas, and of course, the USA. Whether it's the latest in scientific innovation or the shifting landscape of global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage, and it goes far beyond just headlines. Look, if you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a new understanding, a deeper one, of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. I subscribe to them, and it's an investment into your intellectual growth. It's one that you won't regret. As a listener of this podcast, you'll get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now let's get back to the exploration of the mysteries of our universe. Again, that's economist.com/toe.